You don't have the speed to be able to run around and do the whole lake. You got to catch what's ever there,
well,
you know?
There's so many people ignore this as a bass lake. So many guys are so focused on stripers. This might be the best fighting bass lake in the country. I would think you can make a legitimate case for that.
Jimbo,
if it's not,
probably
what?
Jimbo probably would agree.
Yeah, most people would. I mean, if it's not, it's certainly one of the best. Mm-hmm. And it's really good striper lake. Yeah, I'm going to start rambling off. I've got questions asked.
I got a question right now.
Go ahead.
Before I forget it. I've been totally tripping out on the spot-tail minnows that I'm catching on the shore with a cast net for the last couple months because of one of your videos I saw on YouTube. So the question I have for you is, I didn't think they'd be here right now. When do they leave? And when do they come back?
Well, you can actually catch them. That's a great question, by the way, because it is seasonal. And if any of you aren't doing that, you need to be doing that.
It is tons of fun just using that cast net.
And if you just want to catch a fish, there is no lead pipe sure thing scent. That's as close as you'll ever find.
Yeah.
And if you drop one of those and they won't bite it, just go on to the barn because you probably ain't going to catch them that day. They love spot tails.
Yeah.
But what the key is, the colder it gets, the window of opportunity to catch them shrinks because they'll get shallow when it's hot. You ever notice in the summer when it's really hot, the sun's straight up, they'll get right up on the beach. Mm-hmm. Early or late, they might not be there. You know, and you have to back off the bank. They'll stay more like 8 to 12 feet. They love to get up in that hot water. So what will happen now, if you get a day like we had yesterday, we had a lot of sun. In the middle of the day, they're probably pretty catchable. They'll get up on the bank. If you go into, say, November, there might be an hour or two during the day when the sun's straight up at the hottest part of the day, they'll get on the bank. Other than that, they're really hard to catch. I don't know where they go. I don't know where they go after really mid-November. You rarely see them. But that's one thing. If you're really diligent about picking the best time of day, pick somewhere where the sun's beating on it, you can't catch them on into the fall.
3 or 4 casts in the brown water, no good. I threw out my green water a little bit, boom, 20 of them. 20 of them, but I'm like freaking out.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, I love it, man. Thank you.
But they're the best bait for spotted bass, particularly. Stripers eat them too, though.
Will they?
But now, it's been my experience when I can get them in the winter, I'll catch some fish with them. It's just another bait. Uh-huh. Like if you could get them in December and go out there and drop, they'll bite them, but they'll bite a herring or a shiner just as quick. But when it's hot, that's just about cheating, man.
It's fun. It's what it feels like. It feels like cheating.
It is. It's just a matter of sometimes getting the bait harder than catching a fish.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
So if y'all are fishing spot tails, you need to try that. They'll go to any time of week.
And that cast net was a blast, man. That's where that is.
Oh, man.
I'm looking to see if I saw it just beat. I just
caught about 15, 18 right there.
Okay. The more sand, the better. Were you chumming them up? Yeah.
Chum with grits and then done.
Yeah. Grits.
Blast.
Yeah, they're native to the Chattahoochee River. The best way I can describe it, if you haven't seen one, if you've ever seen a horny head creek chub, you took the horns off of him, that's what you got. And he's in the same family, some kind of chub. They're not in a lot of lakes. There's something similar to it in Hartwell, but it's not as big. They get about that big, and they're really too small to get bait.
It looks like a microscopic redfish.
Yeah, they're a lot larger than they can. You'll see them that big once in a while. Every once in a while, you'll see a 4 spoon, maybe 6. But that's on the high end.
Yeah.
Most of them are 3, 3.5, 4. A nice bait size. What's really good about them, you'll find that they're bulletproof.
They're bulletproof.
You don't have to put any salt on them. Just give them a little bit of air.
Yeah.
And they're easy to hold, and they live fairly well on the hook. But the best thing about them is they're free. They're usually easy enough to catch. If you run out of them, just run your boat up on the beach, get some grits, vanilla wafers. They love vanilla wafers.
Okay.
And that's good. If you, Rich, you have to cook them vanilla wafers, you can eat them with them. You know, they're like benefits, right? So there you go. And grits, they just don't taste good until you cook them. Vanilla wafers are perfect. But any kind of food, breadcrumbs, anything, you know, if they're there, and usually, this is a trick that'll help you with spot tails, though. Sometimes you pull up to a pretty big beach, it may be 100 yards long, and it's sand. Somewhere on that beach, I promise you, there's a scoop of spot tails, but you got to get him to you. And throwing out the grits, the vanilla wafers, he's way down there, you may not see them. You'll take something that's got some shine or flash to it, cast it down the bank, and reel it up. They'll fall it right under your boat. Then you feed them, then you catch them. If you don't get them that way, throw it that way, just reel it back. They'll follow almost anything. If you've ever watched this, next time you're catching, take a herring or take your net and dip the scales out of your live well and shake your net out. They'll come to those. They love shiny
scales. Right?
Yeah. And they're omnivores. They'll eat stuff. I've actually caught a few of them jigs. Not crappy jigs.
Yeah, right.
A little bit of jigs.
Yeah.
So they're pretty plentiful and pretty easy to catch. catch, usually as soon as the water gets 70, which is, you know, first of April, then they'll start to flood through the banks. Can y'all hear me all right?
Can you catch them on a sabiki now rig with a little shiny?
You can catch them on a sabiki, but it's a whole lot easier to net them.
Okay.
And even then, it's easier to get you something like a number 14 hook.
Okay.
Take you some good fresh loaf bread, follow it up in a little bitty ball. I'm talking about, you know, the size of the right tip of a pencil. Stick it on the tip of the hook, some 2-pound test and flip it out there. That's actually quicker than my experience.
Okay.
And with the net, this is one thing, because I don't want y'all to get busted and tell the warden Mack told you to do that. Technically, it's illegal to catch those fish in a cast net.
Oh, really?
Well, if you read the rules, there is a list of fish that you can take in a cast net, and it's not in that list. So technically, but it's a rough fish. I don't know anybody that's ever been busted. I don't know any warden ever said anything about it. I don't think they care. I catch them in the net all the time. Because it takes too long to catch them in the rod reel, realistically. So I don't think it's an issue. We've actually talked to DNR about possibly initiating the process to get him included in that list. But that's a long, tedious process. I mean, because it's have to go through legislation, I imagine. So we're working on that. But just be aware of that, technically. It's just like, can't shoot a bear in Gwinnett County if he's in season, because Gwinnett's not listed as one of the counties that have bears. Nobody bear hunts, really doesn't matter, but it's a very technical, very gray issue, but just, I'm telling you now.
The law says that the law says the ladies don't enforce it.
Absolutely. So,
I didn't know that. I'm glad you heard that. I got to do it under the cover of darkness.
Well, unfortunately, you know, our DNR, those guys are really strapped. They're asking our rangers to do 3 times as much, but 3 times less than what they had 10 years ago. If we have if we lose a law enforcement guy to attrition of any sort, they're not replacing. So that's why you don't see them anymore. I mean, I never see them. I haven't been checked. I don't mind any checking. That's his job. In the last year and a half? Man, you don't need to buy any lottery tickets. Maybe you do. I don't know. That's bad. You beat the odds, I can tell you. And sometimes they know me. They know they're not going to bust me because I try and really stay legal. But still, sometimes they come by, you know, and get everybody hold up their license or something. I didn't even have one be bad for 2 or 3 years. But I know they're not out here like they
were. 5 years I've been checked once. And yeah. I thanked them for checking me.
Absolutely.
All these jacklegs out here operating dangerously.
I couldn't agree more. And you know, one reason now, too, they're not checked. I don't know what your deal is.
It was one of the
you really pissed somebody.
You have a bulldog on your boat.
Because normally,
a lot of times they don't check fishermen because we're the most legal group on the lake as a general rule.
Yeah.
I mean, more so than any other group of boaters. So they're wasting their time to some extent. I don't know. They've been drawing a lead on you all the while.
Up at 2 Mile.
Okay.
It was on Saturday.
Okay, that explains it. No, you probably, that was probably just probably going wrong. But now I'm still not encouraging to break the law. I'm like you, I want him to check. Most of them are. Most of them are really cool about it. They don't take a lot of your time. They're just doing their job. So, and they've got a really, it's a pretty thankless job, really. I mean, they get kicked around by a lot, because a lot of people don't have your attitude. A lot of people get mad when they get checked. I mean, they're really out there to protect us. But anyway, any other questions about the spot tail? I'd take some with me tomorrow. So,
yeah.
I'll talk to you a little bit about, and if I start, I don't want to bore you, so tell me if this is all something you're going to do. Tell you a little bit about the state of the lake, where our striper fishery's at. You know, we had we had 3 years where our fish had really, really poor survival rates. 9, 10, 11. Fish they stocked just didn't do well. We don't really know why. It was kind of a statewide problem. And if you had some tough times in 11, 12, and 13, that's why. You were fishing for a lot less fish than we used to have. So there's your excuse. You had 4 days. To compensate for that in 12, they stocked 675,000 fish. That is double on the north.
I've seen more schoolies this year than I have in the past 5 years.
There's arguably more fish in the lakes right now than there has been. Now, if you've seen your average size go down, that's why. The fish from 12 were about like that.
Yeah.
Nice size fish. But that year, too, we had really, really high survival rates. We don't really know why. When they stock those fish, there's a real short window. So what they have to do is get them in the lake right after the shad spawn. You know, a lot of people don't realize they stop them, they're as big as a thumbnail. I mean, they're tiny, tiny fish. And when you're that big, there's not a lot of prey available. So if they miss that window, the shad gets too big, the amount of forage available to them is small. they get them too early, there's nothing. So they try and time it. It's like a 10-day window. They hit it right, and all those little shadow there, and they got abundance of food, and that jacks up survival rates and gets them to the point where they can eat other stuff. So that's their whole objective, and that's pretty hard to do. Evidently, that year they did it. And there's other things that influence that. But where I'm going with all that is we are probably, depending on what the fish that were stocked this year did, 16, 17, 18, maybe it was one of the best years we've ever had.
Awesome.
Ever in this lake. And that's saying a lot, because you look back in the early 2000s, this lake was strong as an ox. We had a really nice mix of size and numbers. And now, we've certainly got the numbers, and I'm impressed with how quickly they're growing. I started catching those fish from 12 2 years ago in October. They were only this big, you know. I would catch them with jigging spoons, little stuff, crappie fishing. They wear me out, you know. And now, of course, they've grown, and they're big. They're plenty big enough. But that year class will carry us a long way. The year after that, they stocked 400-something. And I forgot what they stocked this year. But with any luck at all, if the year classes from 13 and 14 do well, we're in really good shape. So be encouraged. We're going to have arguably as good a striper fishery, maybe in the southeast. You know, you won't see the huge fish like you might see up in the Tennessee Valley, Percy Priest, 10 to 4, where they're growing bigger. Yeah, a little bit better water quality up there. Or somewhere like Cherokee, where they seem to have big ones and numbers. But we're gonna be strong. We came through kind of a rough time, so we're through that. We're past that now. Things look really good. The spotted bass population is strong as not. We've got good numbers, and we've got a lot of nice spots. They're really good fish. So a lot of us tend to, particularly in the early 2000s, striper fishing was good. I think people kind of blew them off as a secondary fish, and I don't think they are. And I think your approach of fishing for fish is great. That's a fun fish to catch. But moving forward, we ought to be in great shape. Now let's talk about what's going on right now. If any of you didn't do well in the last couple of weeks, you can blame that, I think, on the lake. The lake's turning over right now. I think in the guts of it. Any of you probably remember Reggie Weaver. He used to be our biologist. I don't know, he's retired several years now. And I think Patrick, who just left, did a really, really good job. Okay. Patrick left and took a job with Georgia Power. I like Patrick. I thought he did a good job, but you hate to see that continuity broken up. Chris Looney, the tech, has been with all of them, and he'll do fine. But we got to get him to break in the new biologist. But so there, I feel like there is some. We need that continuity because we got the lake back on track. But a lot of the information I'm going to tell you comes from either Patrick or Reggie. Reggie says that the lake takes from roughly the middle of September to Christmas to turn over. That's a pretty lengthy. Now, the bulk of it happens in October right now. And you can see it in places. I don't know. This water from here looks pretty good. You know, it turns over different places, you get different water conditions. Like, you may go into 2 Mile and drop a herring down there, and he lives great at 30 feet, no problem. But you come over here and drop him 30 feet, and he's dead in 2 minutes, literally. And so you have to move a lot. You get a lot of inconsistency. I've been doing this for 30 years now. I can look back and tell you October, historically, has been my worst month for my entire career. That's great. We got a tournament tomorrow. That's a way to get y'all pumped up, right?
That's why they caught a lot of fish out here.
But that's not to say you can't catch them, but there's just so much inconsistency. The bad thing is the lake's beautiful. And it's usually not crowded, but it's a good month to go to the ocean. So, but that's always been the case. I think it's better this year, and a lot of it's because of the numbers. All these little stripers we got have changed it. Any of you seen schooling fish out there today?
Yeah. I started seeing more schools about 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago.
Yeah,
more than I had this.
Yeah, I think the density. I think density of fish is what creates schooling. That's competition. With all these little guys we got out here now, that looks to me to be stronger than it has been years past. So hopefully we'll see more of that. And I was going to tell you, be watching for them. You know, the stupid things may pop up at anywhere, anytime, at any place, and then you may never see one.
Mack, I have a question.
Yeah.
And it's based on what you said about the lake turning over. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go back 2 years here.
Okay.
Set a pattern to try and understand what's going on. So, not last year, but the year before. Right at Thanksgiving, mid-lake, Gainesville area, we had an incredible top water activity. I mean, just for days. I mean, you could go out there. Of course, it was overcast. It was foggy most mornings. You could literally catch fish to your shoulders on top of it fell off. They're at Asardis Creek, Ada Creek there.
Okay, and then you said that was 13?
Not last year, but the year before.
2 years ago.
All right. Literally, it was insane. Most top water activity for 5 days that I've ever seen. Last year, and not to mention just beyond that, you had a super concentration of fish pushing shad, fingerling shad, up onto that peninsula there at Holly Park all day long for a week. Just they herd them up, push them down, roll down the bank, go back out, herd them back up, and you could literally get a fly rod and, you know, sit off the bank and catch fish. But they were 7 on top one. But what I'm saying is, compared to last year, and I'm getting towards the relationship with Lake Lanier. Last year, the creek total, the fish never seemed to turn on for that early fall going into winter, just a free for all. It seemed like we really didn't have a shad off, and if we did, the fish were not interested in eating. So I'm kind of interested in your opinion on the difference between the year before and last year.
The whole guess is what we were just talking about. You had good, really good water in that part of the lake. That you saw that. You know, turnover is affected by so many things. If they were pulling water really hard, that's what I was trying to think back.
It was more the year before. Well, last year the lake was pretty full all winter.
Yeah,
and they didn't draw down the lake.
We stayed for turnover. Yeah. Could have had good water in that part of the lake.
Yes.
That would be my guess. For whatever reason, the water was good there, and you had a lot of bait and a lot of fish, and they were really active because they had good water. When I'm talking about water quality, don't interpret that as being pollution. When I say water quality, I'm talking about purely just O2 level.
Right.
So, because the lake's in good shape as far as having any toxic stuff. I don't think that's an issue here. Based on what I see from DNR and EPA, so we're good there. But yeah, it's probably water quality. And I see that there's a blitz every year about that time somewhere, if you can find it. Well, I think they're getting ready for winter. I think they know it's coming. They're eating. They're getting, you know, they're trying to, they're really active.
Bulk up.
Yep, bulk up. The water temperatures are such that, you know, when you start talking about, probably you're looking at water in the 60s, I'm guessing, mid-60s, low-60s, that time of year.
Yeah, probably.
Okay, that, you know, 60 to 65 is a really good number for them. They're really active. They're It's cool enough that they're not lethargic, but it's not hot. They're not lethargic, and you got the fall and winter coming on, so they're trying to bulk up. So that I see that every year somewhere. I hope I do. Some years more than others. I also think that part of the lake generally is better now in November because I think the turnover has less effect there than it does here. So I'm not sure why.
So how about this theory? Okay, so this was what was happening in the GON forum about the Walt. There was no surface activity last year. It was because of there was a severe cold spell during that time frame, and they had a major shad die-off because all the shad was up on the top, and so they all went down, and that's where the stripers ended up going. They just, instead of a lot of surface activity, they just went down where the bait was.
That cold snap, if I remember right, that was early December?
No, that was in like a November, October time frame. It was it pushed all, it was a real bad cold.
I don't remember.
And it pushed all the shad back down deep then, so they were not on the surface anymore.
Well, I saw that. I had a really, really good November, December last year, but it was all umbrellas.
Yeah.
25, 28, 30 feet over hump. I didn't see enough fish on top water fill up 5 minutes.
Yeah, right. there was nothing on top. It was all deep.
It was either an O2 level, like you're talking about, either it did something put the bait down there where they were with the bait, or it did something with the O2.
Right.
Sometimes I'm not sure when you get
this time of year, and I need to monitor this more. All of them, none of us paid attention to O2 levels like we should. The DNR does some profiles and they share
it. I get those in right
now. Yeah, that's a really good, this summer it's really nice to have that information. I don't know if they do it in the fall, but I'm not sure when you get cooler water sinks because it's denser. So you get a layer of cool water and then it warms up again, like you're talking about happened last year. Mm-hmm. And then maybe you get warmer water, you get all kind of layers in there. And that layer could be oxygen rich or bait could be in it. It may have more algae in it, the bait are in there. This kind of stuff, it's really hard to monitor. But I did see that happen. It was a great bite, but it was all deep. Mm-hmm. I was getting enough fish on top water.
Zippo top water.
And I didn't see them. And we thought, because all those, last year those fish from 12 were 2.5 pounds. And I really thought those fish tend to school more than more. They're like a hybrid of that little. And I thought last fall we just see them. I didn't catch them. I had to catch them deep. It was good. I made my fish, but it was different. So, but yeah, I think that's all water quality issues and very hard to monitor. It's hard to know what's going on 30 feet. It's very hard. None of us, there's pH issues. There's all kind of shears and thermoclines, pH shears and stuff that we can't see. But it's got something to do with that. And I don't know if we'll ever figure that out. I don't know if any of us are willing to monitor that kind of stuff.
They haven't figured out how to. They hadn't figured out how to measure O2 levels on a depth finder yet.
No, I don't think anybody. You can do it with a probe, but you gotta have a wire.
Yeah.
So that's what holds that back. The technology certainly there. So I don't know of a manufacturer that has a probe that you could put. That's a good idea, actually, where you could have it come up on your screen. I'll mention that to the guys at Hummingbird, because that would be doable if you were willing to drop a probe and take the time and measure it at 5 feet, 8 feet, 10 feet. It would really be good information.
Yeah.
It could be invaluable, actually. So.
NGTO purchased an O2 set, software and probes for the river, for the hatchery, the trout.
Okay.
And they're really expensive.
Yeah.
Really. It's $3,000 for two probes and the software.
Okay, that addressed that issue right there. That's why it's not out there.
Well, they'd have to.
Now, the probes aren't near that. Software package was probably about $2,000.
Okay, that's a lot
of money for something you got to stick someplace that someone can pick up on the
highway.
Yeah. So, a lot of these guys here don't spend as much time on Lanier as maybe I do or some of the boat guys do, and have not established a clear yearly pattern, and you can always use process elimination. The limitation of a kayak is the angler has to make great decisions about where he's going to fish based on the information he gathers. In your opinion, what would be the quickest way for some of these guys who don't get to spend a lot of time on Lanier to gather information and or make decisions about where they're going to fish season?
That's a great question.
All day long.
It's what now? Well,
instead of calling me and asking,
get up at 5:05 and listen to you on O'Neill's report every Saturday morning.
Yeah, and I don't usually give places because places change so much.
Not necessarily places, but as far as research and gathering the information and making those decisions, what I know there's no such thing as shortcut because I've done this myself for a long time.
What you have to do is do a log book history.
I just was wondering if you had a piece of advice that you would think would give them a direction to pursue.
I don't know of a source of information that would tell you. A log book's a great idea. You have to keep it 3 years probably before you start seeing, clear-cut trends. And it's a lot of work. Of course, now, when I started, we didn't have software programs where you could do it on your phone or your PC and keep a pretty good log right every day. And it did. It took me really 5 years, I'd say, before I got started getting good data. So that's a lengthy process. Probably you're going to have to rely on information between yourselves. I don't know. Clay Cunningham does a really good fishing report, and I don't know if it's place specific. I do a good fishing report, or I'd like to think it's good. I try and make it good. Every Friday I post it on my Facebook page, but I don't put places. But I will put something on if I think. And a lot of times with our reports, by the time it gets out, in 4 or 5 days, a place is worthless. Yeah. So I'm more worried about telling you a depth, a pattern, a technique, a bait. And I'll noodle on that and let Greg know a good source. Probably you're going to need to, where you buy bait, you're going to need to ask them. Where's the best place to put in?
I cruise boat ramps. If
the
boat ramp is crowded, then you know that's where the fish are.
There's a reasonable belief, or that makes sense.
Yeah.
Let me noodle on that though, because I understand your dilemma.
What
I
found
for the
kayak, as far as the kayak, when I first started, I didn't have the resources that are available now. When I first started trying to catch a striper, it took me 2 years to start putting the information together. 2 years of unsuccessful fishing. Wrong places, wrong times, wrong baits, wrong depths, the whole scenario. Until a couple of, and I'd like to share this with everybody, I have with others before, is gathering information while you're on the water is more than just what you see on your depth finder or around you. I mean, far as what other boats are doing. The first thing I think that led me to becoming successful is noticing what other boats were doing around me. And then if they left, going over and glassing the area with my fish finder and seeing where they were at and why they were there.
Sure.
I kind of, and this is just my opinion, growing through some of the guides' fishing reports online, going through the years and backlogs, realized that they weren't really time-specific accurate, or either they were very vague and mid-lake, downlines, over the channel. Well, that covers 100,000 miles of area, it seems like, you know? But what I did find out is if you read the archives, you have a logbook right there.
That's very
true. If you can start process of elimination, paying attention on what's on the water, what other people are doing on the water, it doesn't take but a couple of trips to get dialed in from the kayak. Because like I said, you have a limited range, you can't run from mid-lake to south end.
Right.
So you're not going to be able to check 10 or 12 spots in one day. You're going to fish one area and you're going to fish it hard. But gathering information is really important when you have limited range.
Sure. No, that makes sense. And what you said is true. I know we archive our fishing reports. And if you went back and looked at the report from the second week of August this year, the second week of August last year, to the second week of August before, you'd probably see some real clear, probably the same, to be honest with you. And even... I will think about that, Walt. That's a good point.
Even if it can just be north of 2 mile or south of 2 mile.
No, I understand. I do what Walt just said. You know, I think in this week's report I think it said the mouth of the middle part of the lake was the best.
Right.
Which is still, now we've got a haystack and half a needle. A half a needle haystack. What do you know what I'm trying to say? We've really not eliminated the process enough to make a difference.
And
so,
I wouldn't want yourself or anybody else to tell me where to drop my line, because that takes the fun out of me, or the satisfaction out of me finding the fish and catching.
But it would be nice if you knew where to put in to start looking.
Yeah.
What's unique about Lake, guys, here is that our forum, and I think it's one of the best forums probably maybe in the United States, because we post on our forum that we caught fish, you know, wherever. And so the guys said, we're going fishing the next day. Okay, where can we go? And we'll look on the forum. That's where the fish were caught.
That's great.
So that's what's unique about our forum and the information that we disseminate to our members.
That's excellent. That's invaluable, too. So.
You report on our forum, too, every week. We post on our forum.
Okay, good.
You do?
Absolutely.
Except nobody believes anybody caught anything on shrimp.
I do. The way I do. I believe that. Actually, that doesn't surprise.
Sorry, Clag.
But y'all feel free to use that report. That's why we put it out there. I really want you to, hopefully you glean something from it. I will ask around, because I see it would be great if we could get y'all something with, say, fish, like you said, middle part of the creek instead of the middle part of the lake,
yeah,
or the south end.
Well, and your reports are very articulate, but they almost cover everything.
It's too much.
It's, you know, I was doing umbrellas, and then the top water, all in one report. You've done five types of fishing.
Well, I'll say this to that, that they can't do that because they have a limited amount of information that they can get out there, and they can't really home in on it because you just can't do that.
I report, I'm mandated to keep it, try and keep it under 600 works. And I'm trying to pacify the crappy guys, the bass guys.
And we appreciate it.
Actually, what you read sometimes, I'll go back and read it, and somebody's knocked out a paragraph. That's a paragraph you should have left in, you know. But that and that's always going to be a problem. Because when I sit down and write that thing, a lot of times it's 600 words. Nothing.
That's the whole thing you have to write, right?
But it's actually easy to write, and I don't mind doing it. Yeah. I mean, I just crank out 600 words. It's like, wow, I got to stop. I had to go back and start taking stuff out. So, and I don't know how we're going to get around that right now. We might try and do something more extensive. That's a good question. I don't have an answer.
Mike can do this for you. He can book you a guide trip. That's right. You'll know exactly where to go.
Yeah, there you go. I don't mind sharing places because, one, it's a big lake. There's a lot of places.
Yeah.
I mean, if I told y'all, if I had a place right there, I said, you look there right there on number 11. Go there and catch it. I'll go somewhere else. It doesn't matter. Or I'll even come in and fish with you. Okay. And it's not going to bother me. When we've done fishing reports, I never felt like we used to do one for, some of you may remember, we did it by subscription only. And I'm talking, I spilled my guts. I told you I called them right here before GPS, or I'd give them the GPS number. But I would say I called them with this. This deep, doing this time of day, on this place, and this place, and this place. And I updated it twice a week. And I'd come back in on Wednesday and say, okay, same thing's going on, but I also found them here, here, and here, or I didn't catch them here. And that never bothered. I never went out on the lake when I went somewhere and there's 10 boats sitting on my first dock. So that doesn't bother me. I also really believe this. Fishing's been really good to me. I try and get back every way I can. I want somebody to catch a fish off a direct result of something I published or said. That's the very least I can do. This has been, I made my living doing this, and I never lose sight of that. And anything I can do to help anybody, particularly kids, I'm all about that. So don't perceive that as I don't want to tell you. But I also, like I said, I tell you, okay, they were stacked up on such and such a place, and they all had this happen. You know, you go back the next day, you're trembling. There was somebody there, and they didn't fish anywhere. That's the nature of a striper. They move a lot. So. And one thing I tell people, too, you cannot become too enamored with a place. And you've all seen this. Sometimes you find a place that's good for a day. Sometimes they'll stay there for a week, maybe 2 weeks. But then some catalyst makes them move. Sometimes I think it's fishing pressure. Sometimes I think a big weather change will relocate everybody. And sometimes we don't see what it is. Bait moves or some of the stuff we were talking about earlier. You get water conditions of such a, no, they're not happy there anymore. So they leave. And that's just the nature of fish, that fish, a striper. Bass aren't as prone to be subject to that, but that's that'll never change, I don't think. But I'll noodle on that. Now, when you guys go into somewhere like Hammonds or Oakwood, are they pretty good about giving you a place? Or do you need it prior to that plan? Dr. Greg, before y'all have a function. But good Friday night at 8, because I'm on Thursday first. And if you guys would contact me the Monday or Tuesday before, I'll tell you where I'm catching them, if it helps. But don't get mad if you go there and they're not there. That might happen. But I'll be glad to help you.
Even just cutting the lake in half. Because, I mean, it's effort. You know, well, most of us are working, right? So the anticipation is just awesome, you know, and you bought something shiny to try because somebody else told you to do it. You know.
I'm thinking if I can tell you a ramp, what you need is an area and a ramp that's fairly close by so we can get you in the hunt right out of the gate.
If you said mid lake, that's 6 mile, 2 mile, you know, straight Shoal across.
Creek, 4 mile, yeah, Flat Creek.
Something to fit. No,
Flowery Branch.
I'm glad to do that.
Or, you know, like Walt, I'm learning everything I can from him, and he says, you know what, in the wintertime, they're going to start moving north.
Yeah.
And so, you know, West Bank or East Bank aren't what they used to be yet. And then all of a sudden, January or February, then Mary Alice. You know,
right.
You know, it's like what?
No, I'll be glad to do that. Just send me a text, and
cool,
awesome.
If I can get you a place, or you know, try and pin it down to a creek or a stretch of river that's a reasonably manageable stretch of river instead of mid lake.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Would you talk a little bit about the movement of bait in general on this lake and from a seasonal standpoint? Maybe starting with the beginning of the year, different types of bait in the lake, where, what they do, you know, what at what triggers certain movements, and like obviously in the spring, you know, that's going to be your best chance, you know, going up in the rivers, you know, using bigger baits to catch trophy fish, you know, that kind of stuff.
That's a great question. Where's the bait? How does it move? Because, of course, everybody, you know, you go where the grocers are. They're no different than us. Typically, if you started January 1st, you know, one thing we've seen, we got three, really four forage fish here, if you count the spot tail, which don't figure in as heavily for some reason with the stripers. I don't, stripers will eat them, but I think it's pretty low on the list. So with stripers, you're talking about threadfins, gizzards, and bluebacks. Bluebacks being the more dominant and I think the more influential of the three.
And how about the trout?
Trout, we don't have a population of trout in the lake, other than the ones we throw back. That's why you'll hear about a guy catching one down there.
He caught one.
Yeah.
Yeah, I caught a 60-incher last year.
Yeah, I catch probably two a year.
Yeah.
And it's usually one somebody either lost or right. threw back in at the end of the day. They had three left, they throw them back. We used to get 100,000 trout stocked in the lake every year.
Wow.
Up until 85, I believe it was. And used to, they'd stock them, and they'd live through the year. We caught really big ones. You got to be an old-timer like me to remember this. We used to fish for them at night down by the dam.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, incredible. I mean,
throw corn out.
Yep.
Nightcrawlers. Yeah.
It was a lot cheaper than buying. We caught big ones because they would carry over. Then it got to the point where our water quality, and again, I'm talking about oxygen, got pulled down to the point they couldn't winter over. So they would put them in, and they would die. July and August, and that wasn't a very good use of taxpayer money. Now those same fish go into tail race behind Russell, where they do just fine. And that's a viable trout fish, which is a responsible thing for DNR to do.
Sure.
So trout, you can take them out of the pictures of forage base. The thing that, and a lot of you probably may not have been fishing here, BH, before herring, this was a different world. It really changed the lake. And I won't say it's changed it for the worse. Actually, I think that's why our spots are where they are now. But what you see with herring, because they're really, really prone to stay deep. And used to, if you started in January, we had fish in the backs of the creeks all winter, like you're talking about, because you'd have lots and lots of thread fins in the back of the creek. Mm-hmm. And they would flush out, you know, the typical scenario, January, February, your weather stabilizes a little bit, then you get a big whopper cold front comes in with a rain dump. Mm-hmm. It clears out, you get the mile high skies, the big northeast wind, muddy water in the back of the creeks, temperatures drop, and it killed it for a couple of days. But they would come back. Now that's almost an anomaly in January and February. And the primary method used to, we just go in the back of the creek, drop out a couple of flat lines, start casting a jig, go down the bank, catch fish with a jig, catch them on the flat lines. And that's still a viable pattern, but it's not near as strong. But if you start in January, now it's become more of a main lake thing to me. You'll see bait deep. You may see bait in the back of the creek, you may not. And it's very inconsistent. It moves a lot. Historically, when you come out of, let's say, if you took a 30-year average and wrote this down, your water, this is remarkably consistent. Your water temperature will hit 50 on February 1st. It'll hit 60 March 1st. It'll hit 70 April 1st. It'll hit 80 May 1st. Of course, now, you know, there's always anomalies there, weather. But when you first see that water come out of the 40s and hit 50 around 1st of February, that's when your threads start getting the backs of creek. And they're usually committed, and they're thick, and they're easy to catch, and they're really, really good bait, and they're free. They're easier to catch than spot tail.
Are they really?
And you can use your spot tail net. That 3/16 is perfect for them, and it doesn't kill them, and you don't gill them, and you'll catch more than you can ever eat. Matter of fact, the biggest problem you have, you pull your net up, and there's 211. And don't put them all in the live well, because you're going to be throwing the net again. Pick you out about 30 real plump, healthy ones. If you run out, you can always get more. And they're so sluggish when the water's that cold. See them on your graph. I mean, literally right there, you throw the net and catch them, or you see them dimpling, you throw the net and catch them. And people are intimidated, I think, because a lot of times they're that big. One of the biggest things I always had to overcome to catch a striper, you know, I'm a big old fish, I need a big old bait. And when it's cold, those little thread fins are great. But if you start in February looking in the backs of the creeks, up
so that's
or
your go-to bait that time of the year, those thread fins,
yes.
That kind of stuff?
Yes, I keep my little cast net. I keep my 3/16 net.
3/16.
And I think when it's cold, you either need – this is a hard concept. You know, the big fish will eat little – I think they prefer the little baits. And you've either got to match the half, so to speak, or you got to put something out there that's so big it sticks out like a sore thumb. I think that's where trout comes in play, or gizzard, because it stands out.
If you ever, you guys have probably seen this, particularly being in kayaks, because you're so stealthy. If you're in the back of a creek in February, March, and you see bait and you see stripers feeding on it, it's in slow motion. A lot of times you'll see a striper just swim around, he'll open his mouth and eat one. Yep. And the shad is so slow. It's all dreadfully slow. Nothing like you'd see out there now. And those threads are so easy for them to catch. I think sometimes that's why they're hard to catch. The threads can't move. It's just easy picking. But it looks like to me they prefer to eat a bunch of them as opposed to one or two big baits.
Is that thread fin, is that the same, the something else pattern for flies? Is that supposed to mimic the thread fin?
Yes, there's a lot of things do, yes.
Okay.
Right. And, you know, they're usually this big.
Yeah, I'm tying those like...
You'll see them bigger. You'll see them smaller. Yeah. And the key with a thread fin when you catch them and use them is match your hook to your bait. Because, again, we're trying to catch some big old fish, have a great big old fish hook. No, not necessarily. You put that three-odd hook, stick that thread fin on there, probably kill him for one.
You can try that, well, like a size three or four.
Maybe even smaller. Yeah, yeah, he won't be able to swim. The hook will pull him to the bottom. And don't be afraid to use, I've experimented with using number 10 trebles. Because he can't see it. The fish can't see it, and the herring's not affected by it. You'd be surprised how well they work. They tend to get wrapped up in the jaw hand.
Where do you hook those?
Yeah, where do you hook those?
In the bottom lip, mountain top.
Okay.
But you'll miss some fish, too, because the hook has such a small gap, the fish will grab your thread pin and just start bolting with it. And when he gets tired of playing with you, he opens his mouth, the hook never got in there. So that's the drawback with them. But if you want to be stealthy, like, I don't think the striper can see it unless your bait looks so natural, and I'll drop down to a really light leader. But going back to what you talked about, that pattern, threads in the back of the creek.
That's like January, beginning of March?
It's sporadic in January. When you get into late February, March, then they're pretty well committed and they're back there. And you got,
so we're talking about up north and south and all
both
over?
Both ends.
Just any creek.
The problem with down here, it'll happen right here. But if you go back to this creek and it's blown out by rain for what you guys are doing, you're in a world of trouble because the next creek, look how far you got to go. Mm-hmm. It's not doable.
Well, I mean, that's when you have right. to even pick up and make, that's, we're talking about what Walt's talking about, where you have to make a decision based on the information you have to, I mean, you, realistically, unless you're flagged, maybe you can't cover more than, you know,
no,
maybe
you,
like
human motor.
3-4 miles in a day is a big, that's a lot for us.
That's a lot more than I'd want to do, brother.
Yeah. I usually travel 6 miles one way searching, if I have to.
Okay. Yeah. And that will be about what you consider the maximum feasible.
Yes.
Okay. So see, if you go up north, the same thing will happen up north. But if you get somewhere, say around Gainesville Marina, if you left Gainesville Marina and you're coming back down lake on the left side, there's about five, six nice feeder creeks there. It will be feasible. It's a long paddle. It would be feasible. And you can put in a Lanier Point Park. That's a good one. You can start right there.
I've actually paddled from Simpson to Holly and back to Simpson and then took out and went to Little River and paddled up Little River to Marker Acre.
That's a long day. Y'all are in great shape. But if you go up there, I think you give yourself more options. And it doesn't have to be a live feeder creek like this.
Strategize on putting it in places where you have more options, like more accessible options in the day, like more different, maybe different creek channels.
Well, that area would do it. You would have the 4 or 5 creeks right.
So it's not really a north or south pattern. It's just giving yourself more of the options.
Right. Okay. No, that'll work anywhere. I do think it's better up there. I think the pattern's better. I'm not sure why. A lot of times you get a little bit stained water. I think that makes us
closer to the rivers, maybe? Is that,
what
maybe,
now?
Maybe because they're closer to the river feeding it? Or
I don't know if that has any bearing or not. I like the stained water that time of year. I think they're easier to fool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm kind of an anomaly with guys. I do a lot of artificial. I do a lot of casting. I like to cast. I don't have a problem with bait, but I love to throw a bucktail. I throw a lot of jerk baits for stripers.
Do you put out your own bucktail line?
I do.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I caught my biggest striper. 36 pounds.
Excellent. That's good. That makes me
I was going to ask you, there are some of us on the forum that have, we don't use bait anymore. All we use is lures.
Okay.
Are we hosed? I mean, because sometimes there's guys around you using bait and they're catching, and I'm trying every trick, and I've got every Captain Mack of every one of these lures, and just nothing. And then 3 days later, your bucktails are bringing them up, and they can throw prime trout down. But anyway, for those of us who don't want to use live bait, I mean, are there times of the year we should just stay off the water and give it up, or try different technique, try, you know.
No, you're not hosed. It's not that bad. There are times you're going to be at a very specific disadvantage.
Okay.
You know, I love to cast, but I carry bait with me every day.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but you're doing it for a living. Yeah. Most of us are doing it for a living.
Make a statement or just a can you catch fish where there's not any fish? Can you catch fish where there's not any fish? No, you can't.
Okay.
But you got to be where the fish are. I don't care what you're throwing.
I understand what you're saying now. Yeah. I thought you were going, can you keep seeing those sonar?
No, you can't throw any kind of lure out there.
No.
The best lure in the world or throw minnows and there's not any fish out there.
That's so simple. It sounds facetious.
Yeah.
Reggie told me that at any given time, in any given lake, 90% of the fish are in 10% of the lake.
That's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
You ain't in that place, buddy. That's bad odds because you're right.
There you go.
You can be doing everything right. You got the best lure. You got the best equipment. You're working it to a T, but he can't bite it if he's not there.
There you go.
That is, and it is. It sounds so simple.
That's why you spent 30 years doing what you're doing, because you know where they you think they are.
I know, and I think they are.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Not every day is
no. Most days, I don't think you. I think you can catch enough fish with artificials. Most days, you're not hosed.
Yeah. Okay.
There's going to be the exception to that.
Yeah, but I don't mind because I enjoy the paddling too. So it's not that. If I paddle in and I'm, you know, it's not a big deal. I don't take it personally like some guys do. It's just, you know, it's fishing.
Fishing.
Yeah, that's
it's
it.
Fishing.
Yeah.
And if you take a guy, you mentioned fly fish. You look at
beats the hell out of work.
Henry never catches the numbers that we do, and that's nothing against Henry. He's most people don't realize on what level of fly fisherman he is. I mean, he's on par with people like Lefty Craig. Yes, he's that.
Really?
He's very accomplished. He doesn't toot his own horn. He is, you don't see it if you're not in that circle, but he is very, very accomplished. But he's accepting the fact he's not going to catch fish like he can with fish, and he's all right with that.
Yeah, so I'm okay too.
That's where you're at.
Yeah.
Most days,
yeah.
Yes, you should be able to catch enough fish with artificials, particularly when you throw bass in the mix.
Yes, and that's my favorite.
Okay.
The green fish, you know.
Yeah, there's going to be that occasion maybe in the summer when you got that big wad of stripers under the boat. And when you're fishing bait, at that point, you're feeding them.
Yeah.
But even then, a lot of times you can catch them as fast with the artificial. I'm convinced when I'm power reeling in the summer, if I've got them on the boat, I can catch one power reel just as quick as I can with a herring. And what I can do that you can't do with a herring, I can get him off my hook and get my bait back in the water, and I'll have one hooked up, chances are, before I can run to the bait well and get me another herring.
Yep, yep.
So there's times, too, I would turn that around. A guy with an artificial might have an advantage.
Absolutely.
Because you could, yep.
I fished a tournament like 4 weeks ago on the lake, and it was a 3-foot chop with 25-mile-an-hour winds. We had one guy flipped, and we call it a yard sale when you lose all your gear.
Okay.
But I'm probably more of an accomplished kayaker than the guys who were fishing this tournament. And I knew when I went out there that it was going to be tough.
Yeah.
Because you couldn't even put your paddle down.
Oh, I can't imagine.
So I got on a school of schoolies almost right away. I dropped one of your bucktails down, nailed the first fish, dropped it down again. They didn't touch it. I grabbed a spoon, a lard spoon, dropped it down, nailed the second. Two fish limit. They wasn't monsters. I like with this water, that's gonna win first place. I'm getting off the lake.
Yeah,
I place fifth because I believe somebody cheated, but that's neither here nor there. But the thing is both fish for that tournament in the first hour of the morning was on artificial.
Yeah, no, it's not always a disadvantage. So I would never look at it like that.
Do stripers spawn in the lake?
Great question. Do our stripers spawn? A striper, this is the same striper that if you went to Montauk or Hatteras, this is an Atlantic strain striper. He's a few generations removed. He's an anadromous. He lives in salt, falls in fresh, and goes back to salt. That's why you get this big migration where fish go up in the river, and it's very incremental. They don't just go up there and come back. They'll actually start in November. And some of them don't go. Some of them stay down here, but you'll have a percentage of our fish that actually go up in the hooch, or the chest team, more than the hoot. They go up in the river, and when they spawn, they don't build a nest like a bass does. Female gets up there, and when everything lines up, she just blows eggs out in the middle of the river. Male comes along behind her, blows the milt out in the middle of the river. It all is a big fish suit. The eggs fertilize, but it's hatched. They had to float in moving water for about 48 hours. This river's not big enough.
if you went somewhere like the Georgia coast, like the Altamaha or Savannah, where you got to have that kind of river system. And we just don't have here. There's only like 9 or 10 reservoirs in the country.
But I mean, from a concentration. So we used to fish the Susquehanna Flats, the northern part of Chesapeake Bay. Is there that here? Can I go north in February and just nail the stripers?
Yeah, it's probably not that consistent.
Oh.
But you would. Yeah, I think you're better off from Thanksgiving through, I would say, the end of March. You're better off up there because you have this transient population. Mm-hmm. That shifts the fish per acre count much higher up there than it is here. It's also more concentrated because when you're down here, like somebody mentioned Mary Alice. Fish are bad to get back there in March. But think about if they're not back there or if the wind's pounding on it, that's pretty protected. But my point is, if you fish this creek and it's dead or they're not in here, then you've got to pick up, put it on the trailer, or you got to paddle forever. And up there, you've got a lot of options that are much more, and there's more fish up there per acre. So you don't get natural reproduction, but they go through the spawning process. Ritual, and you do have more fish up there. And you've got the big females up there.
And will they spawn, so, you know, also on the bay, they spawn up the creeks.
You will have some fish. I think there's a population in every creek down here, small, but some of them will go in the backs of these creeks and spawn. Or they'll spawn out on bar, something like the two reef poles are sometimes.
But the spawns won't live, so they won't become generational. So in the bay, they go back to the same spot every year.
No.
They won't do that.
You're not going to get any probably zero natural production here, reproduction. If it is, it's so small it wouldn't supplement the fishery. Possibly, if you know, maybe you had a really good year and the water's up, the river was flowing good, you might get a few. There's only, like I said, there's nine or ten lakes in the country where they're documented significant or enough to contribute to the population, a spawning striper population. Like Texoma, their fish spawn. But it's very rare, and it
spots,
doesn't happen yet.
Are they successful in their spawn?
Spots are very successful, they're not spot.
They're not all spot. I'm new
to
town, so.
No, they're very,
very successful.
They do well here because what happens with the spots, they spawn a little bit earlier than the big mouth, about 3 weeks. This goes back to that forage thing. You know, when you're that big, and you think about right again, there's not a lot to eat out there. Okay, he spawns 3 weeks before the big mouth, so he's at a remarkable competitive advantage. By the time the big mouth spawns, for one, they've eaten all the little bitty stuff, so the big mouth doesn't have anything to eat. Plus, the spot's physically bigger because he's had a 3 week jump start, so he can outcompete them. That's why he's our dominant fish. But they're very, very successful because they'll spawn deep, they'll spawn on the main lake. You know, big mouth gets back in that pocket, he's that deep, the lake goes up or down, he's in trouble.
Yeah.
Spot will spawn out there, he might spawn on a bank right here in 20 feet. That's probably the very high end. It's probably more like 4 to 8. The little water fluctuation doesn't seem to bother them. So they do better in that regard. And they're the dominant fish here.
And they're spawning. When are they spawning down?
April.
Here? It's April. Okay.
Most of them.
I had really good luck the first week of May. I was nailing like 18, 19 inches. And
yeah.
I was like, man, this is fat and fun.
You probably had some spawning fish then too, because, you know, it's not everybody goes at once.
Yeah.
And you may have a few even spawn as late as June, but the bulk of them will go in April.
And they spawn before largemouth.
About 3 weeks.
That's
generally.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
That's where I grew up fishing up in Illinois. So it's
yeah, that gives them that competitive advantage, and that they'll probably never change. We have seen a little bit of uptick in our largemouth numbers when we had real low water and how that junk grew up the backs of the creeks.
Yeah.
You had abundant cover. Right now, there's a lot of really nice largemouth in the lake. They're probably 4 pounders, 18, 19, 20 inches. Beautiful fish. That's a result of that. It'll probably go back the way it was. So, but you know what? I personally think a spotted bass is a better game fish than big mouth.
I totally agree with you on that.
I would rather catch
them. They're more aggressive.
Yeah,
I think they got better stamina. I like to fish deep water stuff, and I love the stuff we do out here, you know, fishing deep water structure. I really like that. Spots are so much more conducive to that, so I think it's a better game fish, and I think the largemouths, I like them like they are. It's a nice novelty.
Let me ask you a question about the spots that we're talking about them. So over the past 5 years, I've noticed a trend. So a lot of people who go out particularly fishing for spots, they're going to focus on points, they're going to focus on humps, docks, things like that. They inevitably end up constantly catching 12, 13, 14 inch fish.
Yeah.
However, fishing for stripers, most of the guys are catching spots that are schooling with the stripers that are in the 4 to 6 pound range.
Yeah.
So what's the difference in the fish and their habits there?
Well, those big spots, I think when they get big like that, they're a little bit different animals. I think they're a little more prone to be owners.
Bunch up. The little ones, when I say little, I'm talking about the fish that are barely keepers, just under. They really like to bunch up in big groups, and particularly in the fall and winter. I mean, big numbers, 30 or 40. I don't ever see a lot of places where you see a school of big stripers. Now, you might have a piece of structure that's big enough to hold several big, you might catch six big spots off one hump or out of one ditch. But I don't think they're schooling. They're on that structure, and it's a big enough piece of structure. And I wish I could show you this and remind me to tell you about ditch fishing, because this is something that would really be good for you guys, catch some really big spots. But that's the difference. I think the bigger they get, the more they become very object-oriented. I think they move less, and they're not as gregarious. So the little ones, I don't know if it's safety in numbers. And you might have noticed it, let's see, it would have been fall 2 years ago. We were seeing huge schools. Do you ever see them? They were about that big spotted bass. See them? They were big enough you could see them on the grass, but you couldn't catch them because they were too little. Or most times we couldn't catch them. Because unless you had like something, maybe a plastic worm, and then you couldn't stick them. It took me forever to figure it out. I finally found on some trapping jigs and started catching them. And we had a real good spawn that year. But the little ones just love to be together. So I don't know. But the big ones, I think you'll find, like right now, a good pattern y'all want to try. You know, you play around with Ben Parker spoon?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
That, you know, they made that for bass. Ben Parker made that for bass. You'd be surprised how many 2-pound bass at least.
Really?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. But think about it. Everybody looks at it and says, oh, it's too big, so big. How many of you have pulled a 14-inch trout on a playing field? And it wasn't too big.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's smaller. It's, or a 10-inch gizzard. It's as big as the average gizzard shad.
Yep.
It's really not that big. And we've all caught little fish. How many of you caught an average size spot on a 14-inch trout? I'm thinking, what were you thinking when you tried to catch it? So, I had pretty good luck, and that's something I got to work on. But if you will get in a place, just a cove, where the timber's about 30 or 40 feet, take that Parker spoon and throw it as far as you can and let it hit a treetop and start reeling.
Really?
Yeah. Now, it's going to get hung. It's going to come out every time. The problem is you got to get on top of it.
Yeah.
Shake it. It's so heavy. It might take you a while, but the body of the spoon will keep falling below the hook. It'll knock it out. You'll be shocked at how many big spots. Now, you won't catch a lot of fish doing this. When you catch one, you will not need a measuring board. And you'll get some big stripers come out of the timber with it.
Yeah.
It's something I got to work on more. We don't know how that spoon's going to work in the winter yet. We haven't had it long enough.
Okay.
But it's something, if y'all got one on board, you might want to play around with it.
I was amazed because I've caught fish on that spoon. Just vertical power reeling with it.
That was phenomenal.
Yeah.
Absolutely phenomenal.
It's like you drop it. You watch it fall, you see the fish on your graph, you start reeling, your rod goes,
amazing.
Bam.
I had more fun with that this year, and I caught so many fish with it, and I've done it on other lakes. It's phenomenal. It's really a good tool, but it's got a real good place for bass fishing that none of us are using.
Excellent.
Myself included. I played with that some last year. I'd really like to refine that. I don't know how well it's going to do in the winter when the fish lock in. When I'm talking about winter, I'm talking about really,
really cold.
40 degree temp.
Okay.
Because again, like I was telling him, I think smaller baits tend to be better when it's that cold, so we'll see. But then again, you can compare it to, okay, we got a school of threads down here, and there's that one big bait that sticks out like a sore thumb. Maybe it works, I don't know. I put it down after last winter, to be honest, or after last summer. I power reel with it. I don't know why I stopped using it. But something to think about there. And now this ditch, go ahead.
In the spots, you used to do that when it's 55 degrees or less, power reeling vertical with it. Spoon these days, but with the guy a couple times.
Yeah, vertical jigging's incredible technique, and I'm real big on spoons. From actually, I've decided anytime you can get on top of a fish, the fish vertically, he may bite it. We all use spoons in the winter,
right.
And I think that's when it's strongest. But you'd be surprised how many of them will bite it. They'll bite it in the summer. Anytime if you can get on top of him, there's a good chance he'll bite the spoon. Doesn't have to be cold. So yes, I think, and that's a good rule. If you've got water below 55 degrees, you'll have fish in this lake deeper than 40 feet. That's pretty, not all of them, but there'll be enough down there you can target that. And a really good pattern that will work so well for you guys, two things that I want to mention, is ditch fishing. Now, a ditch is a pretty vague term, and a lot of, when I'm talking about ditch, to me, for something to qualify as a ditch, it's got to have at least one vertical side. I'm not talking about a drop, I'm talking about vertical, like that. And if you'll, gosh, I'm trying to think if I've got any of this on our webpage. The lake is full of roadbed ditches. Now, this is not a ditch where, I'll see one like that. You see this cove over here? A lot of times those will have a drain coming in it, not a live creek, but a gully that's washed out. You fall it right and you see it. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about something where you're riding along. If you see it on your sonar, it's going to make this picture. It's going to go from 30 to 40 and then back up to 30. And I mean sides, really well defined like that. Now, here's the kicker. You don't see the fish. You're going to think there's nothing down there. Now, I used to dive a lot, believe it or not, years ago. This is back before we had depth finder. You don't need to dive now. You just look and see what it is. It's amazing to me. It makes me mad. I got cheated back when I started. But I used to dive a lot, and I would go look at these ditches, and on that vertical wall, because our machines, as good as the machines we have, our machines are great, they can't show you in 3D. You're looking at one surface. If you look at that, and most of them are made by road beds or somebody, and I don't understand why you would dig a road out of a hill like that. I would love to talk to somebody that worked here could answer that. But they all have pits and crevices and rock. They're covered with rock. They're also covered with big crayfish like that. I didn't even know they'd get that deep. They look like lobsters. The orange fish, they're beautiful. If you ever catch a fish out of one of these ditches, try it. Put him in your live well and leave him in there for an hour and a half. I almost promise you he'll spit up pinchers and shells or half of a crawfish. And like I said, I had no idea they would get that deep. That might be the draw, it may not. But more importantly, on those structures, there's so many holes and pits. The fish get in them. You can't see them when you ride over. You won't see a fish until you usually, sometimes you'll see them sitting on the top of the ditch, or you might see one in the bottom, but you just say fish too. A lot of times they're loaded. When you start fishing and you hook one, then you look at your sonar here, they're all wiggling around. They're moving then. But if any of you are using hummingbird sonar, and you've got a Lake Master chip, these things are easy to find because the contour lines jump out at you. And if you want to go look at one to see what I'm talking about, the next time you're fishing, tomorrow, if you're over here, Shoal Creek number 9. Okay, it's right around the corner. Come out of this creek, there's the bridge, you turn left, it will probably be the second or third point on the right, but it's got marker 9 on it. It's one of the most prolific ditches in this entire lake. I fish it all the time. And what's good for you guys, they're big enough. Some of them may be a couple hundred yards long. Now, that you know, they're generally going to get deeper as they come off the bank. So you might not have the 40 or 50 feet that are in the right depth, but they generally hold good numbers of fish. You can just park on top of them and catch them. You can catch them with spoons, you can catch them with worms, you can catch them with jigs. And they're a lot of really, really big spots. And the thing, these things are all over the lake. They're all over the lake. They're difficult to find because a lot of them are unimproved roads and they're not on a map. Some of them are. Except if you look at your Lake Master, when you see one, it'll jump out at you. There's that one at 9. I'm trying to think of another one. I can tell you it's easy to find. Generally, if you look around the boat ramps, a lot of the old ramps were built where there was a road that entered the lake. Mm-hmm. So you've got something out there that was there. Those create that situation. Look at a big creek. Big creek's got a monstrous ditch. You're literally where that old road comes in out there. Go look at that if you're over there. Those are an absolute gold mine when the water's below 55. You'll catch numbers and you'll catch big fish. You catch a few catfish to go with them, which a lot of people don't like the catfish, but
they eat good.
They ain't good. He pulls on my string. That's what came out. We got some of the prettiest channel catfish I've ever seen.
Some people even try.
That's what they put them here
hush
for.
Puppies with them.
That's what I think they're here for, brother. That's I tell people all the time, if they want to keep a fish, they catch those. I have trouble getting people to keep them.
Huh?
People say, I want to eat a fish. That's the one you want to eat. Trust me, he's good. He's a good table puppy. But they've got a stigma about him. It's a catfish.
What about walleye in the lake? Are we dreaming?
I'm done.
Oh, okay. No. Forget it. No, I'm sorry. Are we dreaming? Should we go to North Georgia and just forget about it? Or is it
yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
First of all, I got to tell you one more thing. We'll get back to the walleyes, I promise.
Okay.
I got to formulate. I got to have time to think of an answer. No, just kidding.
No, you don't have to answer it.
The other thing I was going to tell you, in the middle part of the lake, I was telling you about. And this is great for what you guys do because you got so much water that's so accessible where you don't have to run all over the lake. Again, when the water gets below 55, somewhere around Thanksgiving, if you go to that same area, Gainesville Marina, there's all kind of little creeks and fingers in there. Go back to where it's 40 feet, maybe 35.
start fishing and fish out. Probably you'll see some deep schools of baits. You may or may not. You don't have to have the bait, but it's a plus. But most of those will have some kind of channel in it. It might be really small, or it's either, if it's a creek channel, you know, you're talking about something that's literally that tall, 3 or 4 feet, because it might be silted in, or it just wasn't a big creek. It might not have been a live creek. It might have been a ditch running in there. You'll start following those out, bouncing that spoon along those. That is a gold mine. You'll catch lots of spotted bass. You'll catch a handful of yellow perch. You'll catch a channel catfish, whether you want to or not. It's amazing how many stripers will blow. I don't think they're down. The spots will get down in that gold. I think the stripers tend to move around them. These are like a road, so to speak. They're not laying in it, but a lot of times you'll be spooning, and boom, you look at the sonar, and there they are, a whole herd of them. You catch one or two, and then, of course, they leave. But that's a good pattern because you could go from finger to finger without moving far. You're also pretty sheltered from the wind in that part of the lake. And that pattern's been working for me for the past 30 years, from Thanksgiving all the way into early January.
Awesome.
Now, if you're really lucky, you'll catch a walleye doing that. But damn. Still, I'm talking about, I'm probably averaging about 8 a year.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. But think how many days I fish. That's really pretty poor.
Yeah. So, I mean, if we really want to target that.
Leave this lake.
Is there a lake up in, you know, in Georgia that you would go without, you know, having to go up to upstate New York?
Go to two.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, guys go up there and catch 8 or 10 pretty regularly. Enough you can get a fish pie out of. We don't know. It's driving me nuts that we can't catch this chicken. But here's what I know about it. Believe me, I have beat our DNR guys to death for information. If I ever can find somebody that catches one, I just drill them to death. I want to know where you caught him, I want to know how deep he was, I want to know what you caught him with. And here's what we think's going on based on my limited, very, very limited catch rate. And see, a lot of you probably didn't know this. They were stocked here in 1960. Y'all know that? We got our first walleye stocking in 60. From 60 to 65, they put walleyes in the water. Well, then, at the time, I think they were spending a lot of money on them, and because they weren't getting a good return on the dollar, and they did better in North Georgia, they stopped stocking Lanier. Well, we kept catching that 2 or 3 a year all through that time. So we've got a sustainable spawning walleye population. This lake's been there forever. In 04, they started stocking again. We get about 300,000 walleye a year. That's how many stripers we get. Now, I thought DNR, I was really questioning. And DNR says, and I'm not saying they're wrong, this just blew my mind. We get a better recruitment rate of the fish stocked here than we do in the North Georgia Lake. But you can't catch them. So go figure. So here's what we think has happened. There's two strains of walleyes. At one point, they were getting walleyes from way up north, and then they start getting to Tennessee, and those fish are kind of completely different entities. They act differently. We know that a lot of the fish on the lower end of summer get really, really deep. I'm talking about 70, 80 feet. And they won't gang up. And DNR thinks that, you know, you got an acre of timber, there'll be a fish on this tree on the bottom, you know, 40 feet, tree top, water's 89, he's down there on the bottom, there's another one on that tree. They're really going to be hard to target. It's going to be hard to catch that fish in the summer. That's what up there they get in big wads. Now, the strain of fish we get from Tennessee probably do that, and they tend to stay in the little river area. Mm. And they don't come down here. Mm. Yeah. Okay, but then why aren't we catching them? Because we're beating that water dead. And we're also doing it at a time of year when they'll be shallow, relative to a walleye. You know, less than 25 feet, which on Lanier I consider pretty shallow. So, and I do know that a lot of the accidental walleyes that I catch are in that part of the lake. It's in the spring when I'm striper fishing.
Okay.
We think what's going on, if you start talking to people from Tennessee that fish for walleyes a lot, they use a lot of really, really small baits, like crappie baits, like a 32nd ounce jig head and a piece of a nightcrawler. They fish super slow. We think everything we're doing is too fast and too big.
Okay.
Every once in a while you get one hit a herring. Every great once in a while.
Tim caught a nice one in 2 miles. What?
What'd you catch him with?
Blueback.
Yeah. On the down line?
Yeah.
How deep was it?
35 to 40.
Did you get any more bites you thought were walleyes?
Well, when I started reeling it, I thought, I can't call it turtle. There was no, like...
You said they're lazy. They're pitiful fish.
Oh, yeah, it's like... And then Bill said, it's a walleye.
Yeah.
And
I was
like, oh man, this
thing's ugly. If you ever get another one,
I understand they're really good.
Oh, no, I eat
them. Oh, no, they're fabulous. I do think it's a lousy game fish. I'm wondering why everybody up there gets so excited about them, unless they fight better up there.
I moved from Cleveland. That was the thing, man. Lake Erie isn't the same, but they feel like they fight like an old boot, but they taste like magic.
I've never caught one that impressed me at all with his ability to pull. And I've caught some pretty big ones. And it's more like I got one. No, he's on there. No, are you doing that to see what the heck it is? And you think it's a stick, and you pull it up there, and it's a 4-pound walleye. Most of the ones I catch are doing exactly what I was telling y'all in that part of the lake, Thanksgiving to Christmas. I'll get 4 or 5 every year. But I never catch them in the same. I can't tell you this creek or this point in this creek or this ditch or this pond dam or this cone have walleye.
Just happenstance.
I just catch one down there.
Okay.
I've tried to.
Thank you.
I have tried so hard to pin them down, and I can't catch enough of them to put together any kind of a pattern.
Gotcha.
And I'm really surprised that more bass fishermen in the spring are catching them with crankbaits. I know they're crankbaits. You're talking about clean rusty.
Yeah.
You look at the magazines, they're using crankbaits. But that's the gist of it. We think we're fishing too fast, too big, as a general rule. Now, the problem is nobody's willing to put the time and effort in to find them when you can go catch, you know, all those spots that pool washes are.
Yeah.
They're a novelty, they're an enigma, and I would like to know how to catch them just because it's embarrassing so bad that I can't catch one. But I don't think anybody will ever put the time and effort into it to, like they do with spotted bass, to see how they move from one season and what kind of structure they're using.
Gotcha. So
they are pretty object-oriented, evidently. DNR sees a lot of them in brush piles, but a lot of times it's A-fished. And that's part of the problem. They don't, evidently, our fish don't get in that big school up you're talking about with an 84 walleye on the sandbar.
That's going to be awesome.
Yeah, well, we got plenty of rocks. I don't know. I've got a customer who dropped a camera on the water intake in the back of Big Creek. Y'all know where it is, that old brick, round brick building. That's the water intake for City of Buford. They will pile up on that thing in the summer. Drop a camera, they're 70, 80 feet. I've been back there and tried to catch, that's one of the few times I've actually tried to catch one. All I caught was catfish. And I actually caught 4 one day 2 years ago in Little River. And all of them know where this place is. No secret. If you were going north or upriver rather, and you left the Chattahoochee and went to Little River, there's an island on your right. And there's a big sand spit right there between. Yep. I just rode over it one day and it's covered up, grass lit up. So I started dropping live herring, started casting jigs, and I caught some stripers and I caught some spots. But I caught 4 walleye. So that made me think they were loaded up there, right? I went back the next day. Second time I went walleye fishing over there, I had minnows, I had little bee hair jigs, I had green night crawlers, I had regular night crawlers. I went up there and anchored my boat on that place. I threw night crawlers out everywhere and I was casting little jigs, all I caught was catfish. I caught like a dozen catfish in a couple spots. So, and I've never caught a walleye off that place since, in 2 years, and I wear that thing out. So that's they're here. And the reason I believe, DNR, they have no reason to fabricate anything. And those guys are pretty up on what they're doing. Right. And that's always made me wonder, okay, y'all guys, you're telling us they're here, you're telling me they're here, but we can't catch them. But when we had that dial, I don't know if any of you saw it. Let's see, this is, I guess it was
2 years ago, when we had a lake rollover in the fall, I saw some dead walleye. Yeah.
Well, no, this was the last week of August and the first 2 weeks of September. I was consistently seeing 8, 10, maybe 12 a day. All of them from Young Deer Creek south to the dam, or downriver to the dam, on the river channel. All of them really nice walleye. Most of them 3 to 6 pounds, beautiful fish. And what happened that year, we had a lot of rain, and there was pretty good water right there. And trying to get water out of the lake, they inadvertently sucked all that good water out of the lake, pulled bad water in it, and they couldn't escape and kill it. But I mean, to see that many every day, and that went on 3 weeks, I thought, they really are here, and we can't catch them. So I wish I could tell you more about it.
That's plenty.
Thank you so much. That's frustrating, because I'd like to be able to catch them, but I don't, we got a lot of work to do. But they're here. We should have a fairly stout population, and they're big fish, too. They're not, they're nice fish.
Yeah, yeah.
And the only thing I've never done that I've done in North Georgia is I've been up there catching with crankbaits at night.
Okay.
In the spring, just fishing rock like you're talking about, something like a deep, just a fairly small crankbait, and they get real shallow.
Up north, pallets on those things.
Yeah, just nothing fancy. I went and reeled. And you would catch bass and walleyes. On a good night, you might catch 8 or 9 or 10. And I've been up there in, I've been up there spoon jigging in December. And you might catch 12 or 15 just fishing points. And they look like a bass on the machine. You look at it, drop a spoon down there, or they would mix in with bass.
Okay.
But I have noticed up there too, I never pull up to a point. Like I might pull up to a place and catch 8 bass with a spoon off one place. I never would catch more than 1 or 2 walleye.
Okay.
Same thing when I was cranking the plug, get one on a point maybe. You have to go 3 or 4 more points. So, wish I knew more about them. It's interesting to me. I think it's great. I'd love to see that fishery develop a little bit.
Yeah.
Plus, I like to eat the stupid things. But, you know, I don't eat them often, I tell you that. But try that spoon jigging thing. That's really for what you guys do. That is so, so applicable to what you're doing.
Okay.
And there's all kind of good spoons out there. Flexit spoons, hard to beat. I think the War Eagle spoon is very good, and it's very inexpensive. Our little jigging shad does pretty well, particularly if you need a small spoon. We make a fairly small spoon. There's an old spoon. You got, again, you got to be an old-timer like me. A Sidewinder is pretty popular. And the same guy that makes the big Ben Parker spoon, Nichols Lures, makes some flutter spoons that are one of them's 3/4 ounce, one of them's 1 1/8. Those do pretty well, and those do well for casting, too. So you can get those same fingers if you'll take that flutter spoon and throw it as far as you can and just crawl it across the bottom. You'd be surprised how it's big, catch some big spots. The best thing about a spoon is you're fishing for every predator in the lake. You'll catch catfish, you'll catch bass, you'll catch perch, which they seem to be on the comeback, which is basically your walleye. They eat the same.
That's what I've heard.
You look at one, you look at them and tell they're real, real close cousins. You know, their body shape's identical. They just don't get big. But that's the best thing in the world about a spoon. You're fishing for everything down there. And the smaller stripers just gobble them up. So, and you will have a lot of stripers in that part of the lake. So that's a good pattern for you guys.
Okay.
And Lanier Point Park, and there's another ramp on the other side of the lake. I can't remember the name of it. We'll give you great access to any of those. Well, as a matter of fact, I see a fair number of yakkers up there. And I
Robinson.
Think that's one. Yes. And then there's another ramp just north of that.
Simpson.
Yeah. So yes, right. Yeah, that pocket, and that's a nice pocket to fish with a spoon.
My back camera.
I think that part of the lake generally is better in the winter, even starting now, than down here. Not that there's not plenty of fish down here. But the search process is so compact compared to what, even if you're not in a kayak, you just got so much water there, so many of those fingers that you don't get down here.
Getting back to the search process, can you tell us any more about like wind direction? You know, we go on Windfinder, make sure it's not going to blow us off the lake first off. And
right.
Then you look at the wind direction, you know, say it's east for a couple days or it's west for a couple days, you know, trying to take that into account as far as bait movement and launching to take that into our advantage. Can you tell us anything about that?
In the winter, the bait's so deep, I'm not sure that the wind moves them.
Okay.
So I don't know. I think it probably has the least amount of influence on the fish that time of year than it does any other time of year.
Seems like there's a lot more wind in the west.
Yeah, it blows every day. And what you're doing, you need to know where it's coming from just for logistics.
Yeah.
And that's another good thing about that part of the lake. You can go to one side or the other and usually hide from it fairly well to the point you can fish. In the spring, and particularly early spring when they're cold, I'm convinced the wind will move them. It'll push them. Those little shad, they're so slow and fragile. And I try and use that. I try and get where the wind's blowing if it's not blowing 38 miles an hour. If you can get a nice 8-10 mile an hour wind, for one, I think a fish is easier to catch. Just got that wind breaking up the light. And the bait's, it's got the bait confined for it. So I try and use it anytime I can. And I think really, other than December and January when I'm doing that deep stuff, like down here, if you took this scenario, you know, we haven't had any wind, but if the wind was blowing that way, I would think that bank, I would try and fish that bank as opposed to this bank,
right,
if it's feasible. Because even if you took the bait out of the equation, I think a fish is easier to catch if you got that wind busting up the surface of the water. So, I would look at it from what you're doing first, how's it logistics, but then try and use it to your advantage, particularly when I really think it makes a big difference is late March and April and May. When you got a lot of really shallow fish, then I want the wind. I want it blowing on what I'm fishing on. And I'm convinced if you had two structures and everything was identical to a T and one was slick, one had that 10 mile an hour breeze, you'd catch more off the 10 mile. Yeah, I really think it makes a difference.
Yeah. side question to that too, like, you know, fishing the humps and all, like we were last winter with the umbrella rigs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you try to go the upwind side of the humps or anything like that, or, you know, because I'm used to fishing a lot of current, you know, from the northeast. So,
okay.
You know, we fish a lot of current.
That's a really good question. And I do think it makes a difference, but I'm not sure it's the wind. But I've noticed too many times I'd pull over a hump and you see the fish, big wad on them, you know, herd of them. And you pull over it, but they would bite. You know, you might go this way and not catch one, turn around and come at it this way and catch two. And then you approach the next hump, and sometimes I can pin it down. And I don't know if it's the wind when they're that deep. Sometimes I feel like there might be just enough water moving down there that we can't recognize, but they're facing that way. Or maybe it's the way the bait's positioned. I don't know, but there is a that's one of the, if I see them, if I go over a hump and I see them and I don't catch them, that's one of the first variables I start playing with. If I'm convinced I got my rig at the right depth, then I will come back to that same hump at a different, completely different angle. I start changing 90 degrees, uh-huh. And sometimes it makes a huge difference. But I can't tell you that they're into the wind or their backs are to the wind. Can't pin it down. I don't see. I see a difference, but I'm not sure that's wind related. Could be. You know, I have seen them diving. Stripers were always hard to see diving. They were very, particularly, you know, because you don't have good visibility in this lake. But you know, I get this far from them, they leap. A bass would go get under a stump and just stare at you. They come to you. I've seen bass, I'd roll over the boat, and you start going down, and they'd be coming. The little ones, they'd come up and see what's going on. Stripers were never like that. It's always like you caught a glimpse of one leaving, or there were 10. And so it was really hard to observe them to see what they were doing. To see that type of thing, okay, you know, is he facing, is it, how's he using a piece of stuff? I can't see it to answer that.
Okay, thank you.
Good question, man. Great question.
This is a basic question. Line type. I mean, you know, in energy, all these different kinds of line, you know, braided and mono and type. I mean, it's great for guys who don't fish that much. How many? I can't have every rod fixed up.
No.
What do you use now?
That's a great question. You know, when I started, you had strand, you had trilene, you had green, you had blue. Pretty simple. Now you go in the shop and there's an 8x20 wall and a lot of stuff. I've been a little slow to come around to braid. I think braid's got its point. When I first started using braid, I had a lot of customers breaking out stuff. So I kind of went back to mono. I use mostly mono bass fishing and striper fishing for that matter. I do like a fluorocarbon leader, particularly when I'm fishing shallow. But a lot of times if I'm fishing deep, I want just straight mono because I think it's tougher. It's more abrasion resistant. You know, I'm like the ditches I was talking about. My worm's down there 45 feet. I don't think fluoro helps you down there. It'll cost you fish, but when you hook one, he's got your line draped over a rock or whatever jumps down there. A good premium mono is tougher, I think, than even a good fluoro. So if I had to pick something, an all-around line, I do like something like Magstrand MagnaFin here for casting and spinning rods. Something's real limp and real flexible. I've used some of the, if I'm going to pick a braid, I really like the fins. Fins make situational braid, and they've got one they call Wind Tamer, and they've got different, you know, they're different shapes. They're round or they're flat. They've got some braids that are really nice on the spinning rod. You know, the worst thing with braids is to get a wind knot. You get your scissors out.
I got one today.
You bird nest, you bait cast,
yeah, you're done. So some of the fins get around that. And a lot, you know, again, so a lot of my customers are really green, so I have to factor that in. And I don't mean that ugly. There's nothing wrong with that. But I felt like I was frustrated before with braid. So I've been slower than most people to go from mono to braid. I do like the braids, but I think a good tough mono, if I'm fishing shallow in the spring, like right now, if I was out here pulling a flat line, I'd want a fluoro leader.
Yeah.
I do think it makes a difference. And what kind of fluoro? Gosh, there's a lot of good ones. If I had to pick one, I'd probably pick the Sunline Sniper. I think it's, I don't know that it's a better fluoro as far as visibility, but it's tough. But yeah, some fluoros don't handle abrasion. They're just not tough. I don't know a better word. Sunline seems to be really, really. Yeah.
What do you mean by the line? The fluoro is not tough because fluoro is more abrasion resistant.
Some of it, I don't think it holds up near as well.
You're not talking about knot fluoro.
No, I'm talking about running over a log or even a fish. You know, if a fish gets up. You know, sometimes you hook a fish and get a line up under him and stuff. I feel like I was losing fish because of it. Now I'm getting more bites in shallow water.
Well, one misnomer is that people say fluorocarbon.
I think it makes a difference in clear water. In deep water, I don't think it does. And
you're using 12? What's your typical?
10.
What are you using? If I do that now, what are you using now?
Almost all my spinning reels are spooled with 10. I spool all my live bait rods with 15 usually, and then that gives me the option of using a leader as big as 14 or 15. But usually I'll use a 10 or 12 pound leader.
You're using a leader?
I'm talking about like on a downline or a free line. If I'm bass fishing, I'm usually using 10 pound mono. I'm tying right to the mono. And I like the 10 for one reason. I think I get more bites with it, even if it's just regular mono, but I think your bait becomes so much better. You know, thicker line creates that drag and slows it down. I don't hesitate to go to 8 pound in a heartbeat. Even fishing deep, I like 8 pound because I can feel better,
right,
and my bait's freer than me.
Right.
Like the ditch fishing thing I was talking about, right, shaky head and 8 pound test would be my bait of choice. With a spoon, I usually drop 10. Just the difference when you're using 8-10, you got to be more diligent about retying.
What kind of knots do you use, Mack?
I use an improved clinch knot on 95% of what I do.
Any loop knots that you use?
Rarely. And a lot of them are good knots. I'm not criticizing. Actually, a polymer knot, if you look at abrasion test, polymer knot shown to be decisively stronger than a clinch.
Smaller.
Yeah, I can tie a clinch so quick. I'm serious, Tom. I can literally tie one in the dark. I can tie it without no eyes talking to you, not looking at it. So a lot of that's habit more than anything. And I found a clinch, you know, a polymer, if you got to send a bait back through that loop, you got something like a big bomber or anything like that, it's a little more, logistics are a little harder. But there's so many good knots, but I can honestly say, too, I don't think I've ever had a clinch knot fail. I've broken my line, but it's not because of the knot. It's because I did something goofy. I didn't check it.
Mack, I'd like to get your opinion on something. So, A, being from the kayak fishing community, sometimes we have to take techniques and methods and adapt them.
Okay.
And change them up a little bit to better suit the vessel that we're using.
Right.
Dealing with speed, mobility, things like that. I'm always adapting and adjusting and trying to process information. And I've noticed over the years that, okay, sometimes in the summertime, you're watching your graph, you get a lot of window shopping. And you start processing that information and say, well, hey, okay, they're coming up, they're looking at it, they're going back down. Why is that? And I found that if I sit in a location and run flat lines, my bait dives down to the depth that they are comfortable at and get hit 10 to 1 of the weighted down lines.
Yeah.
If I'm not moving. However, in a kayak, you need to be moving in the summer and covering territory. I found the magic number to be about 0.5 miles an hour. No faster, because even if you're using a split shot on a downline, you go any faster than that, you're going to pull it up in the water.
You lift them up way up.
Last year, I started testing using a downrigger and running enough line behind it with live bait on it to basically affect a downline at a given depth where I can move.
Mm-hmm.
30 foot over the treetops, moving around. And I found that, on the most part, I'm getting hit on that downrigger about, if I had to guess, about 8 to 1. Compared to the downline.
A traditional downline.
Yeah. What's your take on that?
That's a great point. And I think now, that stealthy approach is more important now. And I don't know, you know, we got a lot of good fishing on the lake. But all of us dropping downlines on them, it's amazing to me sometimes how you can sit on a huge school of fish. And you can watch them ride your baits. Downline, drop a spoon down, whatever, a buck. And they're riding it. They're getting a response. They're right on it. They're looking at it. They don't eat it. But I started doing the same thing. I just take a spinning rod with a split shot on it, pitch it out there and set it in the rod hole. That's the one he bites.
Right.
And it's so much more stealthy. And you're right, the bait, that herring's just like the striper. That striper's down there because he can breathe. He's going down there where he's getting good oxygen-rich water. Well, the herring needs the same thing. So he's going to seek out that by default. He's going down there. He's going right to where your fish are. He's finding your best water. So I think that, for one, if you've got any movement, if you ever see this down, if you were in the water, if you got downline, you're bouncing on, your sinker and bait are doing that. How goofy is that one? Right? That fish got to look at that and say, that's a trick.
Not to mention the bait runs from the fish and hits the end of that gets jerked back.
Because you might have noticed in the summer, the longer your leader, typically the better they'll bite.
Yeah.
Even 12 or 14 feet, which is a real pain to deal with because you got to wrap it around your reel and all that. But I have seen, they want to chase him.
they want, and a herring does best, I'm convinced, is when he's got the leeway to move around. Like I said, you got him on a 3 foot leader, he goes there and stops. He goes up here, probably looks pretty goofy. So I think it's, I don't think you can educate fish too well, but you know, we're always getting a new batch of fish every year. They don't know what we've been doing. They can't share information, thank goodness. So I don't know how much of it is that, but I think it's just that really natural approach makes a big difference. And if you've got a bunch of baits down there, and you got that one, or you got one boat that's doing that kind of stuff, you're gonna get more bites because it all boils down to a better presentation. In this lake, we see that all the time. This lake is a finesse lake, and it gets a lot of fishing pressure, and you got clear water. So anything you can do along those lines help. But that's what it is. I think your herring seeks out the best place in the lake. And he's got the mobility with a split. He can pull that split. He doesn't run into that wall you're talking about. Yeah. So, yeah, anything you can do like that. And I played around. You know, I'm a big believer in down there. Always have been. I've been using down there for years. And the live bait thing is something we neglected. We've always pulled umbrellas or jigs or big plugs, and that works. But a live bait on a downrigger, all a downrigger is a depth-specific tool.
Control, yeah.
Yeah, and now what you said, you got a downline. You got all the advantages of a downline. Without tethering the fish, and if you're moving like you're talking about, he'll swim with you, but he can still do this. He can get up and move around. So you got a real natural presentation. It holds him in the depth you want, and that's a pretty stealthy approach. And I started playing around with more live baits, and I actually had really good luck. Otherwise, just putting a duster in front of him. A little duster like you'd use for a king mackerel, and I just let it slide right down on a live herring. And I had really good luck with that.
What color duster?
I tried a bucktail and I tried tinsel duster, just like you used.
What, any particular color?
No, I hadn't done enough to tinsel.
Oh, the tinsel with the glitter.
Yeah.
Well, down depth, there's no color much.
I'm sure there's some flash on it, but I don't know if it'll be colored. I started playing around with that in the summer. I don't know what made me try that. I have no idea what. I wish I could think back. I'm gonna try a duster. I just
talking Cephas too much.
Probably so. My God, that's a bad prediction. Woo! And that sounds like something he would do. Because yeah. He's got trolling on the brain. He's got mackerel on the brain.
Yeah. So.
But I did have good luck with that, and I was probably trying to do something just a little bit different.
See if it'll work.
Yeah, it's medium. You know, and again, when you're talking about 40 feet, you need a little bit of flash. Maybe that helps. I play around with that a lot more next summer, though. I like that. It's fun.
That's something to file back and
something to build on there.
Yeah,
and it was nice too. When you're trolling with a bucktail, you can't stop or you can't slow down because it sinks. And particularly if you've got it way behind your rigger, mm-hmm. and you got trees. With that live bait, I was trolling more like bumping it in and out of gear. When I saw fish, I just kind of stopped. And I was fishing probably on average 30, 40 feet behind the ball, so I could keep.
I've been running 40 to 50.
Yeah, that's a good little technique. We'll play around with that a lot more. So. I've been rambling for a long time. Do you guys have any questions? Yeah, well, and in the winter, I usually dedicate at least one line to something obnoxiously big, trout or gizzard. For two purposes. A lot of times that'll give me a big bite. Plus, you got all these little threads running around. You got that trout out there. It's really obvious to the fish, when I see him. So I think sometimes going to the opposite extreme of matching the hatch, if it's something so big and so out of kilter, it draws attention to itself. And I do think a lot of times that'll get that big bite. There's a really big, 25, 30 pound fish in there. That'll get his attention. So I might just dedicate one line to that. Historically, I use little baits. I key on the little baits until the water gets back to 60. Then I start getting away from that. That's also the point that your bait fish will start coming out of the creek. The oxygen level. Not in mass, but you'll see them move more in the middle parts of the creek, back towards the main lake. And then they'll start getting on bigger baits. And that's when I kind of start rolling out of the thread fin thing, more to herring or gizzards. I really like the big gizzards. And you know, they'll spawn usually in May. Big gizzard shad on the planer board, on sand places, spits between islands, long flat points. That's a really good pattern. Gosh, really starting as early as late March into early June. Get some really nice fish there. And that's when I do it the other way around. I'll really concentrate on fishing big baits on the planer board. I might dedicate one line to something smaller.
you gotta remember too, I got people in Bunning to catch fish. So I want to keep a herring or a fed out there. I'm gonna play a lot of bass bites, keep people engaged, keep fish coming roadside.
Yeah.
And then if I get a bite on the gizzard, fine. If I don't, the other thing about fishing these big gizzards, it's really fun, it's just incredibly visual. Most of your bites, you'll see the fish chasing the pot, waller around. It's really fun, even if you don't hook it. A lot of times he won't bite it. He'll waller all over. It's very cool to see. And now I'll cast at that fish. But if he starts goofing off, making him, you know, after three or four passes and he doesn't hit it, I'll make somebody throw a jig at him. A lot of times I'll get him to bite the jig. Yep. So, you know, just I don't know why they do that to gizzards, because a huge percentage of them never bite it. Or you can tell that if you don't have a stinger hook in, probably won't catch it. Need to sting them. If they're bigger than that, I'll put a stinger hook in.
What do you think about beavers? So, say, in concert with your jig?
It's hard to do. More often than not, I think it's fun. And it's visual. And now you're talking about like trying to get a fish to something and then cast a jig.
Let me clarify. That may be my terminology.
Okay.
So I use your jigs a lot.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank
I
you very
appreciate
much.
The quality and I like to support local people. So I notice on my graph, when I have a solo fish on the graph, I can't hardly get him to bite a presentation.
Yeah.
By himself. If I've got two or more fish, there's a competition issue in there, and it's easier to entice a bite.
No doubt.
However, I found that sometimes if I'll take a hook, say a one-off hook, and I tie some buck hair on it, no weight, and then I tie a loop knot 14, 16 inches from my buck tail and loop him on there. When I jig that, I've got this big bait, small bait chasing thing going on.
Right.
And it seems like sometimes if I do that, it will entice a single fish to bite.
That's a good idea. Yeah, I don't see why that wouldn't work. It makes sense to me. And you're right, a single fish, you've got too much time to look at everything.
Right.
You know, there's 10 of them. I'm convinced that's why they eat umbrellas. When there's 10 or 15 of them, one of them is going to eat it because he's afraid if he doesn't, somebody else
will. Somebody else is going to get it, absolutely.
It's his world, you eat or you get left behind.